de-accelerating flow. The initial flow when the patient starts breathing is very high and then it de-accelerates. That's how normally we breathe. So the synchrony component is much better with the pressure modes. Now two things we have to learn. Who starts a breath and who cycles the inspiration to expiration. Let us see what it is. So this is what you have to learn now. Who initiates the breath? That means who starts the breath? There are only two components, isn't it? Either the patient or the ventilator. Only one of the two have to start, isn't it? See, the ventilator has to start or the patient has to start. The only way a ventilator can start is only by lapse of time. If you set a time of 10 breaths, every 6 seconds it will start an inspiration. So whenever you are talking and saying that it is a time, a ventilator is initiating a breath in a paralyzed patient where there is no control to the patient, it is always by the elapse of time. So with the patient, there are two ways the initiation can occur. We call this as a trigger variable. It is by a pressure trigger or a flow trigger. I'll teach you what it is and how to select the triggers. So to summarize, the initiation or a starting of a breath can be controlled by only two components or the two players in the mechanical ventilation scenario. The one component is ventilator, and ventilator can initiate a breath only by elapse of time. And the patient can communicate to the ventilator that he wants a breath by two things. One is by dropping his pressure or by drawing some flow and initiating or telling the ventilator that I require a breath now. So that is called flow trigger or a pressure trigger. I'll tell you in the next subsequent slides. And this is the limiting part we have already discussed. What are the two limits? Volume and pressure, and it is always done by the ventilator. The limit variable is controlled by the ventilator in all modes of mechanical ventilation. You remember that. And we have discussed that in detail. Either you set 400 ml tidal volume or say a pressure of 20-25 centimeters. That is the limit you set. So that is why the modes are called volume controlled or a pressure limited or pressure controlled breaths. Then the question comes, who cycles? How do you tell the ventilator whether the patient can go from inspiration to expiration? Again, the only two players or the two actors in this drama are, again, patient and ventilator. In all modes except one mode, this part is controlled by the ventilator. And which is the only mode where a patient can change from inspiration to expiration is pressure support. You remember this. In pressure support is the only mode where the patient can initiate the breath. The limit is by the ventilator. All the modes of mechanical ventilation, the limit is by the ventilator. In a pressure support mode, the only mode where the patient can initiate a breath and cycle from inspiration to expiration, the only mode that does is pressure support ventilation. You have to remember this, and this is very important. That is the reason we allow almost 70% of the time to patient to be on pressure support, because two phases of breathing, breath, every breath, two phases can be controlled by the ventilator. That is the only mode where the change from inspiration to expiration patient can control. And I have already told you the flow delivery. This is a square wave. Again, this is a volume controlled breath. If this is a volume controlled breath, the flow is very constant. It doesn't respond to the patient's requirement. So in a volume controlled, my God, it has gone somewhere. And I think I've closed it. Just give me a minute.
Okay, sir. No problem.
It's open now? No.
No, no.
And then just, I have to close the PowerPoint?
Yeah, the present PowerPoint you close, sir.
Okay. Then I close the PowerPoint.
One which you want to share, you open and keep.
Now I opened it.
Yeah, then now press the share screen button.
Share screen, just a minute. Just give me a minute. Okay.
Yeah, now, yeah.
Now it is visible.
Yeah, this is the simulator.
This is stimulator. See, all of you may be confused. Whenever I touch the mode, this is how it opens. So we'll go one by one. Only four modes will go one by one. I'll teach all the modes in this stimulator except the SMV. I'll just go back to PowerPoint. Not visible?
Yeah, it's visible. I'll just make it... 100%. No. Now, yeah, it's okay. Fine, you can continue, sir. Now, the viewers, what you can do is, in the view options, you can just press the zoom button. In that, if you select a zoom 200 and then keep this in the center, it will be very clearly visible. Okay. So those who are viewing, like in the upper part in green, you will be seeing that you will be viewing the Dr. Chandrasekhar's screen. In the next view options, you press that arrow, then zoom ratio. In that, you can select 200, then you can move it so that you can see the screen in a better way, or keep it in a 150%. Zoom, you keep it at 150. So you will get a better view.
You know, sometimes it may not work because when I zoom to 200, I'm not getting a proper view.
Okay,
so I think maybe, it depends on the screen resolution.
Yeah, fine, fine. Then just...
For me, actually, the 100% fits better. Like that.
Okay, fine.
So we need to make sure that you see the simulator screen maximum.
Yeah, now it's clearly visible, sir. You can continue.
See, now I have to select the adult. Then I have to go for volume control. See, once I go for volume control and accept it, see, now what are the buttons available? I have a tidal volume. So I can change the tidal volume. Okay, I can change the tidal volume. I'll keep it at 500. Okay. See, this is how you set. You have a direct setting of tidal volume. See, you set the tidal volume. Peak flow. Peak flow is nothing but you can, most of the ventilators by default sets the peak flow. Once you set the tidal volume, see, I didn't select the button. See,
sir, can I interrupt, sir, for 1 minute?
Yes.
So many people are asking, what is the difference between a bias flow or the base flow and a peak flow? Or like, what is the difference in an NIV and this thing on a bias flow?
Bias flow comes only at the end of the inspiration. In a ventilator, it's a flow that occurs only at the end of the inspiration, a small flow of 2 liters. You may be thinking 2 liters, but it happens for only 100 or 200 milliseconds. And that ml, if you bring it back to milliseconds, will be in the tune of around 25 to 30 ml. Whereas in a bias flow, in a NIV, is a different situation. Here the bias flow doesn't occur when there is an inspiratory flow for pushing the tidal volume. At the end of the inspiration, at the end of the expiration, when the expiration occurs, a small flow occurs, that's called the bias flow. A ventilator starts a small flow before starting the inspiratory flow. Once the patient generates a negative inspiratory pressure and it senses that some volume has gone into the patient, then the major inspiratory flow comes, and that flow, when it achieves the peak, is the peak flow. The flow that occurs to deliver a tidal volume produces a peak flow. A bias flow is a flow just to appreciate the triggering, is called the bias flow. If somebody had called it as a triggering flow, probably people would not have got confused. Most of the people get confused in mechanical ventilation is because of the bad terminologies and the trade problems that the different ventilators produce, and they call the same things differently and different things same. So that is the problem. It is the flow only for triggering. That's called the bias flow. I hope I'm clear. See here, once I set the, then I have to accept. So now the tidal volume is set. Most of the ventilators generally by default sets, but you can set it, is around 30 to 40 liters. 30 to 40 liters. Breath, we around 15 to 25 is what we have to keep. So around that much is fine. Peak of 5 would be fine. This is the trigger sensitivity I was talking of. So what should be the trigger sensitivity? I would be happy if all of you would remind yourself what is the trigger, what is the trigger setting we should do. Trigger setting should be not more than 1 to 2. See, I have set it at 1.6 liters. This leads to a bias flow only to communicate with the patient or to know whether the patient is able to generate a breath or not. This is the FiO2. See, once I accept this, the ventilation will start. Save and close, the ventilation will start. Some alarms are being wrongly set. So this is how we set some probably the weight. The weight is very low. It's not going up 200. Okay, that's the reason. See, the weight should be around 70. Once we set it to around 70, that should be fine. Okay, that is fine. Accept. So now, once I save and close, the ventilation will start. See, the ventilation is starting. With the tidal volume also is a bit high, isn't it? So we'll cut down to... See, this is how you set a volume-controlled ventilation. See, once I say it is a volume-controlled ventilation, you should understand this is the limit. I'm telling the ventilator produce a flow to generate this tidal volume. And this is the peak flow. Peak flow, we thought we'll keep it this, accept. Then the rate, we said that we'll keep it around 23, 24, accept. Peak, trigger, and this is the FiO2. This is how you set a pressure, volume-controlled ventilation. See, you look at the square waveform here, square waveform, and look at the pressure. Only the peak, highest pressures are only for a small time. Now, see, I'll go for a pressure mode. I go for a pressure mode now. See what, there is no tidal volume here. That's what I've been telling you. Now, to adjust the tidal volume, I have to change my pressure. See, now if I go with this, if I see what is the tidal volume I'm getting here, peak expiratory flows, if I'm getting is around 5.92 liters, and if I'm not happy with this, see, if I'm getting a tidal volume of 200 ml, so how do I increase the tidal volume in this patient? There is no tidal volume button. See, you have to tell the ventilator, I'll give you more space. I'll give you more space for pressure. So now once you do this, you look at the expiratory minute volume, which was 5.6, has become 10.6. The tidal volume has become more, isn't it? See, the only way you can increase in a pressure modes is by altering the pressure. This is the pressure. Is the level, pressure levels, what you allow the ventilator to work is what the ventilator is going to alter the tidal volumes. So in a volume limited modes, by altering the limit of the volume or the pressure that what you have set, if you say at 20 centimeters, you are getting 400 ml, you want 500 ml, from 20 centimeters, you go from 20 to 27, then the volume will increase. This is the inspiratory time. Sometimes IE ratio will not be there. The inspiratory, normal inspiratory time is around 0.8 to 1 second. So 0.8 to 1 second. So you can go up a bit. See, I'm going up to around 0.8. I accept that. Rate is 21. I'm happy with this. See, look at the peep here. Peep setting is low. If I increase my peep to more. See now.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I think the body weight we have to change. Because it's body giving weight, very low tidal volumes.
Body weight is 76 kilos.
76. Okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
With 27.
See, my point is, what you have to understand is the concept. See, what I'm trying to do is, this is a stimulator. This is not a regular ventilator, isn't it? It doesn't work like what probably it doesn't. This open pediatrics was mostly a pediatric one. So probably they're trying to make it into an adult one now. There may be some issues. The principle of a volume ventilation is, you remember, by altering this pressure, you alter the tidal volume. So now that I've set a peep of 15, now you see here, the baseline has shifted. The ventilation is starting from here. You keep seeing, I'll change the peep now. 5, accept. See, the baseline gradually shifts down. See, for next 2-3 breaths, see, already peep is 2, it is coming to the baseline. You can also check the peep. That means the FRC, I have decreased the FRC. If the FRC is more, the inert pressure is more, that's what how the peep works. The sensitivity is correct and the FiO2 is correct. Now we will go to pressure support mode. See, once we accept the pressure support mode, now what we have? We have a peep. Peep of 5 would be fine.
Sir, 1 minute, it's always ideal body weight. One person is asking. It is never an actual body weight because
yeah.
I may be like weighing a 60 kg now or a 70 kg. like in the lockdown, I can eat and gain the weight up to 120 kg, but my lung size will be the same. Or I can do a fasting for like a weeks together, low carbohydrate diet and reduce it to some 60 kg, but still my lung size will be same. So it is always ideal body weight. It is not the actual body weight. Okay, so be very clear in that concept.
And that formulas and how to ready-made charts I will give you when I'm doing a ARDS class. It is always the predicted or the ideal body weight. It's never the actual body weight. We set the tidal volumes. Let us be clear. Then pressure support and trigger is all right, and FiO2 is all right. This doesn't give the expiratory sensitivity. Whereas the Hamilton one gives, there is a Hamilton stimulator you can download. Once you download the Hamilton stimulator, there will be something called as expiratory sensitivity or expiratory trigger here, another button, which will say 25%. So if I want to change the IE ratio, I can make it into 50% to cut down my inspiratory time. In this stimulator, we are not able to get it. That is the problem.
Yeah, so many people are asking like which simulator to be downloaded. There are so many simulators.
Hamilton is very comfortable to download and use.
Hamilton site you go, you register, make an username, password. Then you can try with different combinations. So there is a C6 simulator, that is the best one. The C2 and C5 is basic. The C6 one is definitely having all the options, including adaptive supportive ventilation and esophageal pressure, all those things. Okay, so try to go to the site, see the simulator, you change the different settings and get the real feeling of how to adjust that. We will have a separate session with the same principles using a better simulator and again case scenarios. Because of a shortage of time, we won't be able to give you a case scenario and again running the simulation. Okay, so definitely we'll be having a continued sessions on mechanical ventilation, so don't worry about that. Sir, please, you can continue.
See, when you put on a pressure support, there is no tidal volume. The only way you can alter the tidal volume is by altering the pressure support. If I put a pressure support of 10 or 9, I am getting 300 ml of tidal volume. I expect the patient to generate 450 ml. The only way I can generate the tidal or increase the tidal volume is I give more pressure support, 12 pressure support. Now the tidal volume becomes more. Now I accept and say, see, you see here, what is the expiratory minute volume? Expiratory minute volume is around 11.5. See, now I will decrease my pressure support. You see the It will decrease. Somehow it's not working. Probably I don't know what is the problem. Save and close. But that is how you set. There won't be IE ratio. There won't be rate. There won't be tidal volume. Tidal volume you manipulate by this, and there will be a button called expiratory sensitivity. And by altering that, you can alter the IE ratio. I'll try to find out a better stimulator. If somebody has a doubt with pressure support, see, in pressure support, like any pressure mode, the pressure support level is what is going to determine your tidal volume. This is for triggering, is to for starting a breath. And for ending a breath, you have something called expiratory trigger or expiratory sensitivity. That is set by default at 25%. For the peak flow of 100%, when it deaccelerates to 25%, the inspiration changes to expiration. So by altering it up or down, if you bring it down to 10%, it goes more time. Inspiration gets more time. If you go to 50%, inspiration gets lesser time. That you can control. But the IE ratio and the rate and the tidal volume is controlled by the patient. So that is the beauty of this mode. And most of the advanced modes or most of the modes use this as the mode of ventilation or the delivery, breath delivery. So I would say almost 70% of the patient spends on a ventilator would be on pressure support. So if you have any doubts, you put up your questions. When we come back tomorrow or day after tomorrow, or if you feel it is important, we'll do one session on pressure support only. So
ideal body weight, there is a formula which we will give you. Don't worry. The ideal body weight is very simple.
I'll show you in the end of the session only. So now we will go back to the one mode which I didn't discuss here. The another mode we can discuss here is also is available, but there are some disadvantages. I'll just go through that once for you to understand what are the things. See, now volume SIMV. Once I put a volume SIMV, I am able to put my volume and also I am able to put my pressure support. See, this is a mode where one breath can be a volume controlled breath and one breath can be a pressure support. There the sequencing is different. Two breaths may be totally a breath sequence, may be initiated, limited and cycled by the ventilator, and the next breath may be a pressure support where the patient is able to generate or stimulate a breath. The limiting is by the ventilator, he can cycle the breath. So people think this is a better mode because patient is able to have different types of modes, or during a mandatory mode, patient can rest. That is what has been thought, and people think this is a very good mode because during mandatory ventilation, patient is resting. That is what is the concept. Most of the younger students, younger colleagues of mine have. I've seen this and many people have tried to convince that it is not so. And I'll tell you why it doesn't happen that way. Just a minute.
Sure. Yeah, that sir, that we'll do a separate session, sir. Otherwise, class will get delayed. So, can we move on to the next part, sir?
Just I'm trying to close my Safari. I have to open my slides.
Yeah, that I'll do, sir. I can do from here. Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, please continue, sir.
Yeah, I'll open my slides. Just a minute. Bear with me.
No, that's okay, sir. So after today's session, please go back, go through the lecture once again. We will share the presentation also. So make your concepts very clear. So initially, our plan when we started this platform was to teach you how to ventilate a COVID patient. But later on, when we discussed the scenarios, then we understood that without knowing the proper basics, it is very, very difficult to manage a COVID patient. So with that intention in mind, we started, we decided we will teach everyone the basics of ICU management, especially the ventilatory management. Okay. So
the slides are visible.
No, sir. You have to press share button once. Down share button, green button.
Well, just give me a time.
And again, we have a mixed crowd. That is another problem. I know that those who are many people are there who are doing DNB critical care and all. So for them, it may be very basic one, because the comment what we are getting, that itself will make us feel that issue. But there are many other people as well. We have post MBBS persons, we have medical students, MSc nursing students. So we have to cover all the groups. That is why we are discussing the basic things. At the same time, we are including the advanced things also. So for the beginners, it may be difficult for you to understand the advanced things what we are talking, but don't worry. You just try to understand the basics, like the mode, how to set, all those things are enough. So at least that part, you'll be very clear. Yes, sir. You can continue, sir.
Visible? It's visible now?
Yeah.
Okay. This was what was being asked repeatedly, isn't it? See, this was one of the slides I'm going to, I usually tell, it is always criminal to guess for intensivist to guess the weight. So you should always go with a predicted body weight or an ideal body weight. We generally say you should never ever try to go with the measured or guessed weight. I've seen many people just go and see with the patient and then say, okay, patient is having this much weight and then start ventilating. That doesn't work. You should always go with the 3-4 slides on SIMV. See, SIMV, there is a misconception that people think that SIMV, when you ventilate during mandatory breaths, it decreases the work of breathing and the patient is given rest. and there is a backup rate of ventilation so that when somebody doesn't breathe, it is much safer. These are the two misconceptions that most of you have. Both of things are wrong because all the ventilatory modes have a backup ventilation. If you set up the apnea time, say 10 seconds, the patient doesn't breathe for 10 seconds, whatever mode you have set, the patient goes back. If you say you are ventilating somebody with a pressure support, for 10, 12 seconds, he doesn't breathe, the patient goes back into a pressure control. You can set it. So there is no safety in SAMV. Safety is there in every mode. Next, the question is, see, the next question is, the patient gets a mandatory breath. Why is the diaphragm going to not contract for that breath? How does the ventilator diaphragm know that the next breath is a mandatory breath? It is going to pull. It is going to pull with the same force. And on that, there is a mechanical breath being delivered. So it has been found in studies. In fact, during that mandatory breath, there is a diaphragmatic injury. You just think like this. Diaphragm is contracting, two pressure support breaths are going. Next is a mandatory breath. Why will the diaphragm say that I'm going to rest now? How does the diaphragm know? It is going to pull. It is going to contract. So there is no decrease of work of breathing. In fact, the injury is much more. Another issue is, if you understand, look at this slide. See, in this slide, if you carefully look at this, there is a trigger window. Look at the inspiratory time and the expiratory time determined by the brain. Because this was the pressure support breath and brain was controlling the inspiratory time of 1 second and 2 seconds. Now suddenly you have put a mandatory breath. And what is happening? The mandatory breath is having a long inspiratory time. In fact, during that time, both inspiration and expiration, because of your brain, that is what your brain wants to finish both inspiration and expiration in the inspiratory time of your SAMV mandatory breath. So a lot of asynchrony occurs. Why do you think that the ventilator is not, or your lung is, diaphragm is not going to contract here? Diaphragm is going to contract here.
Sir, 1 minute, can I interrupt? Now people are asking, in our previous sessions, we told not to use SIME. Dr. Shekhar is also saying the same thing. You just listen like till he completes. He's also telling you the same thing.
See, what I'm trying to tell you is, during a mandatory breath, there is a diaphragmatic contraction. So there is no rest. In fact, there is a dissynchrony. Look at the neural inspiratory time. The neural inspiratory time, which was occurring 2 breaths before the mandatory breaths, was this 1 second, 2 second, 1 second, 2 second. Now suddenly we have imposed 2 second and 4 second. How will the brain cope with it? Brain will not cope with it. So there is a dissynchrony for every mandatory breath, and what you thought that you are going to rest the diaphragm is not happening because diaphragm is still contracting. And the diaphragm is contracting in such an extent that it wants to finish inspiration and expiration in this time, but the ventilator is not allowing that to happen. So when the diaphragm wants to relax, it is pushing air in. It produces what we call it as pleiotropic diaphragmatic injury. So if you ask me, there is no advantage in using SAMV. The only, if you look at very physiologically, SAMV is not a physiological mode. If you ask me, it should be removed out of mechanical ventilators. And if you have seen both weaning, all the two studies proved that the patients who were on SAMV weaned late when compared to pressure support and your TPs. The reason being, there is a lot of asynchrony and diaphragmatic injury. You just imagine why diaphragm will stop contracting here. Have you looped your diaphragm and your ventilator? You have not looped. So diaphragm is going to contract. And look at the neural inspiratory time and neural expiratory time. It doesn't sync. So there is dissynchrony. So SIMV is a mode which is very unphysiological and should not be used. So pressure support I've already dealt with. This is what is called expiratory sensitivity. It is there. And another thing that is available in pressure modes is rise time. If you increase the rise time, it is nothing but you are increasing the inspiratory flow. As I have said in the first slide where I showed you a bucket, if you increase the tap, if you turn the tap more, what will happen? More flow will come and the bucket will fill faster. The same thing, if you increase the rise time, the inspiratory flow will be shortened and more time will be allowed for expiration. You look at the flow here in the first one. Flow is taking a long time to reach here. Look at here, it is reaching faster. Look at here, it is reaching much faster. So the tidal volume is delivered much faster than this here, here. So you get more time. So this is one way of manipulating IE ratio in pressure modes. You can alter the rise time. It is called rise time. It would have been better if somebody would have called it as increasing the flow rates. It would have been much better, but it is rise time. But for you and me, you should understand it is just increasing the flow. So this is how you calculate the peak flows. It is a simple calculation. It is not rocket science. And to conclude, I would say you remember these numbers at least. So what mode? No mode is inertly safe. It depends upon the clinical settings, the alarms, and what you are comfortable with. Always don't use what you are not comfortable with. And some numbers, these numbers we are going to repeat day in, day again. A plateau pressure of 28 to 30, driving pressure of 15, tidal volume of 6 to 8 mL per kg, peak of 5 to 15, FiO2 of 100, come down to 50 as soon as possible, a respiratory rate of 15 to 25, a PCO2 of less than 45, and a pH of 7.25 in most sick patients, not for every patient. In a normal patient, we would like this to be around less than 45. And this more than 7.35.
Yeah, one point can I add, sir? In the last part, the PCO2, concentrate on pH at that point. Like if the patient is not having an increased ICP and all, like especially an ARDS patient, don't bother about PCO2 values too much. You concentrate more on the pH side. Okay, so you don't have to look all ABGs and target a normal PCO2. Don't do that. Look at the pH. If it is okay, you accept that. Okay, fine. So now, I think
thank you. I think it took a little more time. Than
That's okay, sir. We will do only driving pressure by Dr. Sanish and we'll close.
We'll just finish any questions if it is there.
Yeah, question we'll take at the end, sir. We'll continue
okay.
that.
Okay, right.
Troubleshooting a ventilator, really, we will have that with the simulator itself. We'll do the troubleshooting. End of every lecture, troubleshooting will be a little bit difficult because of time issues. But we will have a separate session with simulators and the way we did NIV. We will discuss real scenarios with the simulators. And with the online simulators, we'll demonstrate how to do the troubleshooting. PEEP in different modes. The PEEP is same. Like whichever mode you are using, you can go with the same PEEP. Driving pressure, driving pressure, Dr. Sanish is going to explain. Yeah, please.
Okay, friends, after an excellent talk by Dr. Chandrasekhar, actually, I am taking only one particular point only. Okay. So driving pressure, mechanical ventilation, what basically we do is we are pushing some air or a gas mixture into the lung. So now we are speaking only about positive pressure ventilation. Remember that normal spontaneous breathing is negative pressure breathing. Am I audible?
Yes, yes. You can continue.
Okay, fine. So basically the driving pressure concept started when we started describing the baby lung concept in ARDS. Probably since we are starting with basics, it might look a bit out of context. To sum up this thing, probably I'll show this picture in ARDS. This is a CT scan cross section. We can find two sets of lung units. The bottom one, we can find the atelectatic lung and maybe a near normal lung units in the anterior portion, what we call it as baby lung. So it's not the full lung, which is atelectatic or stiff or you know what is compliance. Compliance is distensibility. Okay. Volume change per unit change in pressure. So compliance is less. These are stiff units, what we call it as atelectatic lung. But the remaining lung units, which can still expand on receiving a volume or a pressure, is still good lung with a normal, near normal compliance. So if we can segregate it into two portions, one part probably normally distensible, and the other part is stiff. But what we are pushing into is a lung we can have to consider as a single unit, and probably whatever driving pressure or the pushing force we are giving will distend both the units, or it will reach both the units. So our idea is not to damage or destroy the baby lung. This is where we need to be more worried about driving pressure. Okay. So baby lung, actually in this ARDS lung, we have only a small portion of the lung, maybe of the size of a baby's lung inside an adult ARDS lung. So we can and baby lung, which is very tender, nice, good compliance, and the rest of it is atelectatic lung. Suppose we are giving a small tidal volume, it distends and comes back. Okay, so no harm done. Suppose thinking that it's a full adult lung, we give a relatively high tidal volume, what will happen is the baby lung gets more compliant and it tends to expand a bit more than what it can actually do, because the other portions are not receiving any part of this air. So what will ultimately happen is there will be energy trauma due to this additional pressure, what will result as a ventilator induced lung injury. So if we are not bothered about the driving pressure, what actually we are doing is inducing ventilator induced lung injury. Again, coming back to the graphical representation of the pressures, this is a volume controlled breath. From time zero, after the triggering, the pressure gradually reaches a peak. This value we call it as Anup, my mouse is visible for pointer.
Yeah, clear.
So the peak value is called as pressure peak. Okay, but this is not actually the pressure which the lung units gets exposed to. So we do a small inspiratory pause, and now during the pause time, the pressure dissipates and comes to an equilibrium. Now, whatever pressure we measure at the airway will be equilibrated with the pressure that is experienced by the lung units. And this is the plateau pressure. So, and then we release the pause, exhalation starts. This difference between pressure peak and the plateau pressure is actually a reflection of the airway resistance. So this much energy is actually dissipated in overcoming the airway resistance. So if you remember, if you have a bronchial asthma or bronchospasm or COPD exacerbation, this part will be more. We'll get high peak pressures, maybe of the range of 40s, 45, 50s and all. But as long as the plateau pressure, the pressure at which the lung units gets exposed is within 28 to 30, we are not going to cause much damage. So the difference between the baseline, our new baseline in our ventilation is PEEP, that is a positive end expiratory pressure. The difference between the plateau pressure and the PEEP pressure, we call it as the driving pressure. So this driving pressure actually dictates the amount of lung distension or volume delivered. So driving pressure is the one which dictates how much the lung gets inflated. So again, going back to the equation, driving pressure is the difference between plateau pressure and PEEP. Okay, so now I'll introduce one more concept, the static compliance of the respiratory system. I put it as CRS. Compliance is delta V by delta P. The change in volume now resulted is the tidal volume delivered. Agreed? So the change in volume during this breath cycle is the tidal volume. And what pressure caused the change in volume? This is the driving pressure or plateau pressure minus P. Okay? So we'll come down to the next level, static compliance of the respiratory system is equal to tidal volume divided by driving pressure, or in other ways, you take this to the left hand side. So driving pressure is equal to tidal volume divided by CRS or compliance of the respiratory system. So depending on the compliance, the tidal volume is determined by the driving pressure. I'll come to that in one more illustration. So basically the take home point is the driving pressure is a complementary tool to adjust the tidal volume or PEEP, particularly when you are dealing with patients like ARDS. Again, I have put the graph there. One example, suppose the tidal volume is 600 and our machine shows the compliance of the respiratory system as 25 mLs per centimeter of water. Now, how much is the driving pressure? 600 divided by 25, that is 24 centimeters of water. Okay, suppose we are keeping a PEEP of 5, so you are allowing tidal pressure of 5 plus 24, that is 29. So if you want a driving pressure of 24 to create or deliver a volume of 600 tidal volume, the plateau pressure expected is 29, which is accepted. So now the take-home message is the driving pressure is a surrogate for cyclical lung strain and parenchymal deformation of the functional lung units, or what we described so far as the baby lung. So every cycle during this driving pressure, lung will undergo this strain and parenchymal deformation, and the higher the driving pressure, the more will be the lung strain and parenchymal deformation. So this is one take home point. So now we'll look at two different lungs. Okay, the top one, the compliance is good. It's a thinned out lung. Bottom one, you can see the yellow one, it's more harder, stiffer. So this is to illustrate that the compliance is bad. Now we are going to give the same driving pressure to both the lungs. Okay, we'll see that when that driving pressure is applied, the compliant, well compliant lung distends very much, and the less compliant, the stiffer lung units doesn't much distend. Okay, so this is what happens in the ARDS ventilation. The top one, the baby lung, is at the risk of overinflation or over distension, because we cannot equate these two lung units. These two are totally different morphological entities. Okay, so this is something like a baby lung, where the driving pressure will yield you big volumes. This is the stiffer part, where driving pressure will not give you much yield, much tidal volume. So now in ARDS, we are dealing with the two different types of lung units together. So tidal volume in proportion to the number of alveoli open and accepting the tidal volume is our scenario. Okay, so we have to imagine that we have this much proportion of baby lung, depends on our imagiological investigations, and this much proportion of stiff lung, then you decide on a tidal volume. So we have to come down on tidal volume and driving pressure. That is the message. So driving pressure, if you can keep it something around 15, that will be very much good in an ARDS. So damage to the lung cells or lung strip depends on what? It depends on the amplitude of cyclical stretch rather than sustained level of maximum stretch or maximal stretch. So if you compare these two properties, the amplitude of cyclical stretch has more to do with the damage of lung cells or lung strips. Hope you are following it. So a high plateau pressure or its equivalent does not necessarily represent an increased risk of cell damage. Whereas if accompanied by high cyclical driving pressures, it may result in lung cell damage. So it's clear. So rather than plateau pressure, driving pressure is a key player in energy trauma or ventilator induced lung injury. Okay, so this is another take-home point. So here we have a graphic. There is a peep, so our baseline is elevated. The pressure curve goes to a peak, that is the pressure peak or peak inspiratory pressure, PIP or PP. Then on inspiratory hold, we'll get an equilibrated pressure, P plateau, which is actually the pressure at which our lung units are exposed, and then we go to the exhalation part. So P plateau, we can also designate as end inspiratory alveolar pressure. Just like we speak about other pressures, keep this message in mind. P plateau, we can designate as end inspiratory alveolar pressure. I already mentioned this difference between pressure peak and the plateau pressure is depends on the resistance. When bronchospasm is there, this part goes up. The driving pressure part, that is the difference between P plateau and PEEP, this is related to or depends on the compliance, and the resulting tidal volume is dependent on the difference between plateau pressure and the PEEP. That is our driving pressure. Okay. So delta P, driving pressure is P plateau minus PEEP. And we can also make it as tidal volume divided by compliance of the respiratory system. So top part is accounted by the airways, upper airways or bronchospasm, bronchus, these airways. And remaining pressure is actually what distends the lung units. So this is the message. So driving pressure has more to do with the distension of the lung units. Here is another example. In the tracing, you can find that the peak pressure is 28. PEEP is, plateau pressure is 28 and the PEEP is 8. So we get a driving pressure of 20 centimeters of water. Okay, suppose we increase the PEEP to 12. There are two possibilities. One is, as we can see here, the PEEP is 12. The plateau pressure has increased to 33. Now the driving pressure is 21. Okay, the difference between 33 and 12. The other scenario, PEEP has increased to 12. The plateau pressure is somewhere close to that region only. Actually, it has come down a little bit, 26. Why it should come down? Because more lung units are recruited. Here you can see the driving pressure is 26 minus 12 is 14 centimeter. So the change in PEEP actually opens up more units, and the driving pressure is actually reduced here. So again, another scenario where PEEP is 10, plateau pressure is 21. So what's the difference? Driving pressure is 11 centimeters of water. Here on the monitor, you find a saturation of 88%. Now we have set an FAO2 of 50%. Okay. Suppose you are getting a tidal volume of 5 mL per kg. So you want to increase to 7 mL per kg. Okay. Because saturation is less. So you need to recruit some lung units. So you actually increase the driving pressure to 17 in an attempt to increase the tidal volume, because the driving pressure determines the volume delivered. Okay. So here again, you find the plateau pressure 27, which is also accepted. The other scenario is the PEEP is 10 and the plateau pressure has come down to is 23. Here the driving pressure is only 13. Okay, so what happens with over distension of the alveolus is the chemical mediators get released and resulting in ventilator-induced lung injury, VILI. So over distension, overstretch, dynamic overstretch results in the release of chemical mediators and leads to lung injury. So now what happens at the alveolar level? We'll see. First tracing, we have set a PEEP of 8. You get the trace. So you can find that the plateau pressure is 27 and the peak pressure is somewhere around 35. So now what is the driving pressure in this case? 27 minus 8, that is 19. Okay. Now we increase the peep to 15. From 8, we are increasing to 15. So two possibilities have come up. In the second tracing, the plateau pressure has risen to 36. Okay. With a small rise in driving pressure, 21. Okay. Now we are in the red zone. Another scenario, the plateau pressure actually has come down and the driving pressure of 8 is enough to generate the tidal volume because the lung units are recruited. So in the second case, we can label it as non-responders because when we increase the PEEP, nothing much gets recruited or the plateau pressure is actually increasing with a minimal change in the driving pressure. And here it's a responder. So more lung units gets recruited. So our pressures are better now. Dr. Chandrasekhar, sir, can you comment on this? This study is?
Driving, see, this was a study produced by Amato. This was not a randomized control trial. He took up all the cases of all the ARDS trials and then did a very complex statistical analysis and proved that the mortality is more related to the driving pressure than the plateau pressure. But this being not a randomized control trial, at this present time, I would say that we would still consider plateau pressure and driving pressure and try to manage with both, because this is not a randomized control trial. This only was a statistical and that too a complicated statistical analysis. If you go to the next slide, Next one. If you carefully see, the mortality starts increasing when the driving pressure increases to 15. And if you notice here, you look at the tidal volumes. Most of the tidal volume is around 6 and here it is 6.1. When the tidal volume starts going beyond 7, 8, the mortality is again going more. So in fact, it is also related to the tidal volumes. It's a reflection of tidal volume, how it responds with your number of alveoli. That's what is the driving pressure. And I would say we will look at driving pressure, but we will not abandon the maximum amplitude, that what we call it as a plateau pressure at this point of time. That's the take home. We require to look at both the pressures when we ventilate an ARDS pressure.
Sunny sir, can you just go to the next slide, sir? Next slide. Next one.
No. Forward. The in-between one where there was the tidal volume, plateau pressures and PEEP and things like that. Next one. Next.
Yeah. So here, friends, see what the Armato did was, like previously we had the Arsenal trial where we looked at the mortality, and with those trials, the previous slide, please. Yeah. With those trials, we decided that, or we assumed that the plateau pressure of less than 30 is having a mortality benefit and a tidal volume of less than 6 ml. So as Dr. Chandrasekhar has mentioned, so later on he pooled all the data. Then what he found was, you can see the first diagram here where the airway pressure and again the numbers when he plotted. Here you can see this was a PEEP was steady, then the driving pressure was increasing. Okay, so this is one group. And here we can again see the PEEP was increasing, but it was a responder. That is why the driving pressure was almost same. Okay, it was not a responder, but not worsening. But in other group, you can see when the PEEP was increasing, ideally the driving pressure was decreasing. So this is the actual responders. And this is how we recruit the lungs as well using the PEEP. So the moment you start increasing the PEEP, you can see the driving pressure is reducing. Or in other words, with the same like pressures, you can see the tidal volume will be increasing. Okay. So whenever you increase the PEEP, previously we were looking at the plateau pressure. So now what you have to do is you have to look at the driving pressure. So at one point, if the driving pressure is start reducing, that means like you are recruiting like more and more alveoli. And again, at that point, the mortality was also reducing. So, like, whenever you keep the driving pressure same, the mortality was same. But at the same time, even if you keep the tidal volume constant, the PEEP constant, but the driving pressure is increasing. Sorry, the PEEP you keep constant, but the driving pressure is increasing, the mortality was going high. Okay? The same driving pressure, mortality was almost same. But the, when you reduce the driving pressure, it was coming down. It is actually, in fact, we are not reducing, the lungs are getting more recruited. So with that analysis, he came to a conclusion that, the next slide please. This is a conclusion, like at somewhere around 15. This is again a bit debatable, like the data initially was showing somewhere between 14 and 70. So roughly we can take it as a 15. So at the point of 15, you have almost below 15, the mortality reduction was significant. That is why you always try to keep a driving pressure of less than 15. Okay. So those who are doing DM critical care and all, today go back and read the Abbato trial once again, read it in detail, go back and read other ARDS papers like ARSNET trial and other papers as well. Okay. Yeah. Sir, over, sir. So now, like any other points, after adjusting the people, how many cycles we have to wait for measuring the PEEP light? Or can we measure just after increasing the PEEP?
5 minutes.
Yeah. You have to give some time because the lungs are getting recruited. You are just opening up the closed airway. So you have to give some time. So at least like as he has already mentioned, you give some time, like at least some 5 minutes, see whether what is the change happening. So at least by this class, like that is what we all are aiming at. A few things you have to understand is, like as Sarah's put it in numbers, one thing you have to understand the difference between a pressure control and a volume control. Okay. In the pressure control, to increase the tidal volume, you have to keep the pressure increasing. Or when you put a pressure control, if the lung is getting worse, your tidal volume will reduce and the patient will get hypoventilated. So that concept should be very, very clear. Okay. Then regarding the trigger, you should not try to, I've seen many people, as Sarah has mentioned, like increasing the trigger to reduce the respiratory rate. Never do that. It is just like suffocating your patient. Don't do that. Or like choking the patient. Don't do that. So respiratory, the trigger is just to adjust between a proper triggering and again avoiding the auto triggering. It is not to control the respiratory rate at all. And again, the PEEP titration, now it should be based on the driving pressure, and there are advanced method of esophageal pressure, transpulmonary pressure, all those things, which we'll come to that later. So, but at this concept you should understand, whenever you adjust the PEEP, at least look at the plateau pressure and compliance, whether the compliance is improving or not. Try to understand the concept of what is compliance. And again, don't think that putting a ventilator is just putting some PEEP and tidal volume and you go home. It is not like that. We have to sit with the patient, just like you monitor the ECG rhythm, you have to look at all these pressure variations, see what is happening to the peak pressure, plateau pressure, the patient oxygenation. Based on that, we will have to adjust everything. Okay. The same way, like when you see the ECG changes or like when the patient's urine output dropping, you will be doing something. The same thing you have to do with the ventilator as well. You and your bedside staff should be familiar with how to monitor the ventilators. And one more thing I wanted to tell you, because I got so many messages saying that, sir, we are afraid to ventilate the patients in district hospitals and taluk hospitals because our sisters don't know the basics. See, like when we started the unit, maybe some 8 or 10 years back, our sisters were also like that. It is your responsibility to teach your nursing staff. Okay. If your nursing staff is not capable of managing the ventilator, that is your inability. That we have to admit it. Because every day you should have teaching sessions for your nurses as well. And again, if you have a respiratory therapist, if you're having the luxury of having the respiratory therapist, give them power, let them take over this teaching everything. They are also an excellent group, because majority of the critical care unit like us, we all are having, we have the respiratory therapist, including all NIV setting, high flow setting, the other ventilatory parameters changing, all they will do, and they will help the bedside nurse also. So you should have a team of ICU nurse, respiratory therapist, junior doctors and consultants, and that wavelength should be same. Okay, there are many, like so many people are commenting. The spiritual therapist has a key role in critical care management. That is what is lacking in our government hospitals, we know. But we cannot appoint the respiratory therapist to all COVID hospitals. That is not practical. So you learn the concept first. Go back, teach your nurses how to monitor the ventilator, how to adjust a parameter, so that they should be able to pick up the thing saying that, sir, the pressure is increasing or the tidal volume is dropping or saturation, if it is dropping, like how to increase that FiO2. So you have to train them properly. And it is your responsibility to train the ICU nurses and to improve the quality of your ICU care. So don't blame anyone. If your ICU has not developed, it is definitely your fault. That we will have to understand. Okay? Then what about autopip? Autopip and all, we will definitely take that. And sir, there is an excellent feedback about your class. I'm not saying Dr. Sanish because it was also good, but we are regularly interacting with the people. But very good feedback we are getting. Thank you, sir, so much. And again, we will post these presentations in the FB page. And again, the videos will be available in our YouTube. So please see that. And again, I'm writing my WhatsApp number here. So sorry, 99610855858. So those who are not getting daily alerts, I'm sending daily alerts to everyone. So if you are not getting the daily alerts, please text me in my personal WhatsApp. Or if you have any other personal issues, like in setting up of an ICU or like starting a COVID unit or need a training for your ICU staffs, like please contact us. We will give a module to train your nursing staff as well. Or like we can arrange a separate nursing class session also. We have a critical care nursing team with us. So they will definitely help you how to set up a ICU unit as well. Okay. So with that, again, yeah, we will definitely upload the contact number. I've already put the contact number. And again, I'm putting, yeah, this is my WhatsApp number, 99610855858. Okay. So please WhatsApp me. I will keep you in the group where I am putting all the alerts, and definitely we will update you about all the programs. And tomorrow we'll be having Dr. Chandrasekhar again. Not tomorrow, every Monday and Tuesday we will be having ventilation class. And again, other days we will be having experience session, sharing sessions from international speakers, especially those who are worked with us in India and again now working in centers abroad. So we will be having one Dr. Sudhindra Kulkarni. He was there with us in Kasturba Medical College. Now he's a consultant in intensive care in the UK. So he has treated more than 100 patients of COVID. He will be sharing your experience. And Wednesday we have two excellent speakers in India. One is Dr. Jayaprakash Mullil. He is a former principal of CMC Vellore and the best community medicine person and epidemiologist in India. So he'll be talking his concept on the herd immunity. And again, we are having Dr. V. Revi, again, the best virologist in India, the virology head from NIMHANS. He will be talking about the immunological or immune response to COVID infections. So that he will be talking. Then followed by, we will be having a discussion. We are getting community medicine people as well. So those who are interested to know the epidemiology, infection response, everything, so please watch that session on Wednesday. Thursday, we'll be having Dr. Sudhindra Kulkarni, he will be talking on his experience in UK. Then after that, we'll be having Dr. J.V. Peter on Friday. There is a slight change. Initially, we put it on Saturday. So Saturday is some engagement. So Friday, Dr. J.V. Peter will be knowing us. He's a senior most intensivist in India. He was the former chief of critical care medicine in CMC Vellore. And now he's the director in CMC Vellore, an excellent academician. I think he will be the person with maximum publication in critical care medicine from India. So he'll be talking us on rickettsial fever. And he is the pioneer in India on rickettsial fevers with maximum publications. So whatever questions you have regarding rickettsial fevers, please post it in our FB page. He will be clearing all your doubts. So we will be continue to have these infectious disease sessions, like critical care sessions, and again emergency medicine topics, and some like anesthesiology topics also. It's basically concentrating on acute care medicine, aiming at improving our ICU care, and again reducing the mortality in ICU. And obviously, like as Dr. Chandrasekhar has told, in Karnataka and Kerala especially, and Tamil Nadu also, we have not seen the outbreak or not the any wave so far. Whatever we told is something like a flickering, we can say. That is not the wave. The wave is something different, which we may experience. We can pray that we should not experience that. So at that time, we should be completely equipped to deal with the situation. That is why you all should be equipped to deal and ventilate, and again to reduce the mortality. Okay, sir. Chandrasekhar sir, you want to add something?
Nothing. Anything is there? Any questions? You just WhatsApp me. I'll try to address it before I start the class.
Yeah, Sanjay sir, can you conclude?
Yeah, fine. So tomorrow again we'll have a session on mechanical ventilation. So we'll concentrate on basic modules, and we'll stress more on simulation training, so that whatever doubts you have, actually how to set the flow trigger, how water pipe develops, so all these will come up during our case scenario discussion, and so you can clarify, and so that you can get the concept clear, so that you will get a direct interaction opportunity with Dr. Chandrasekhar. So I request all of you to make use of that opportunity.
Regarding the ICU design, we already had a class by Dr. Suresh from Trivandrum. He's the chief of critical care medicine in ICRA Hospital, Calicut. So we'll get Dr. Suresh again. He'll be joining us. He's also our team member only. So Dr. Suresh will be talking more on the designing of ICU, how to set up COVID ICUs, and again, how to improve your ICU. He'll be talking about the quality aspects, and again, how to set up an ICU, etc. The operation room also, I'm getting so many phone calls, like how to set up a negative pressure in an operation room, whether we can set up a negative pressure or positive pressure, is it really going to harm you if we are going to operate any patient there. So, and again, what are the other infection control measures you have to take in an operation room. So today already American Society of Anesthesiology has already published their guidelines on the COVID, the preoperative evaluation and other things regarding the COVID. So based on that ASA guidelines, we will separately arrange a class on the COVID patients dealing in a perioperative setup. So we are making that modules, myself and Dr. Sanish. So in coming days, we will definitely include that as well. So thank you so much, Sir Chandrasekhar sir. Thank you so much. So we will join you back tomorrow 7 o'clock again.
Yeah.
So same. This whole week we'll be having same webinar user ID and meeting ID and password. So log in with the same meeting ID, password, or the link. And till Saturday we'll be continuing with the same one. So and again, probably if you feel that your nurses also has to be trained, on Sunday we can plan a session for critical care nurses as well. If you all feel so. Dr. Chandrasekhar sir's WhatsApp number, people are asking.
Yeah, you can give.
Yeah, can you just tell, sir?
9845 00 00 9477 9477.
Yeah, this is Dr. Chandrasekhar's phone number. I'm just texted here. Okay. 9845 00 9477.
It's correct.
Yeah.
Okay. See you then tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Good night. Good night to everybody. Yeah.